Bring me up to speed on week before last Bible study lesson, please. What did we talk about? Kim, Mary, Rosa.
We talked about to save my soul, I must submit and resist.
Nope.
It says I have to submit and resist to save my soul.
Submit and resist is what?
Submit and resist, the devil will flee you.
That's how you get the devil to leave you alone.
Right?
Right. Thank you.
We spoke that, I know you mentioned something about each compromise takes away a piece of our soul.
Okay, thank you. We did talk about soul and losing our souls.
Yes.
But submit and resist was not the compromise.
Right.
Mary.
We talked about how to save your soul. Was save your soul by getting rid of all uncleanliness and all that remains wickedness, and with the humble spirit receive the word of God, which is in your heart. That's what it's able to save your soul.
And we talked about the soul because we were finishing up temptations, right? We're finishing up temptations, and how Satan offered us the world, and we ended up on the scripture that says that it is better to not gain the whole world and lose your
soul.
And then we discussed what your soul was. Okay. Kimmy?
All right, I know this one. It is made up of your mind, your will, and your emotions.
Amen. Thank you. Your decision maker. Tony, I saw your hand.
Was already previously mentioned, probably spoke about on one of the scriptures, is James 4. Verse 7, how to resist the devil, submit to God, and he will flee from it.
Amen. We're going to get back to that in a minute, but we were studying the scripture.
Yes.
Wait. Come on. Brother Moley, we want to get you on the mic.
We spoke on being double-minded.
Okay. And that goes along with the part in James, right?
Correct.
Amen. Thank you. Who else? Pastor Bruce,
also,
and
also,
then Rosa.
Do it.
We talked about the soul, and another, you know, the soul is your mind, your will, and your emotions, but also another definition that I believe you gave was out of the Greek, which means psyche.
Mm-hmm.
It means psyche, or that part of a man which enables him to think and reason. And it is the seat of our personality, our mind, our will, and our intellect. So the things that proceed out of our minds and how we think about stuff and how we make our decisions, as your decision maker, and it's all part of our psyche. And what happens is that the enemy, that the devil, wants to steal that from us. So that we can get out of line with God's will, but Jesus, when we let allow the Holy Spirit to take control of our psyche, then we
will follow the Lord, follow the things of the Holy Spirit,
follow the things of the kingdom of God. So.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Bruce. Rosa.
We also spoke about Matthew 16:25, where Jesus says to do business here until He comes back.
Right, that was one of the kingdoms.
Right.
We've talked about that. We're not supposed to just be waiting to go to heaven and get out of here. God wants us to make it to affect the kingdoms of this world, right?
Right. Right.
Amen. Brother Charles.
I think it might have been Sunday when you preached, but I know you talked a lot about we must obey the will of God. You talked about that a lot, because I heard you saying that on about obedience. Just being, mm-hmm. You didn't use that word, but that's what you were saying. And because sometimes it's, I don't know if I brought this up, somebody brought it up, sometimes it's comfortable to be worldly, to be carnal. Mm-hmm. It's uncomfortable to follow the will of God. It's uncomfortable because the flesh is so agreeable with you. You got to constantly be obedient, no matter how you may feel emotional-wise. You got to be obedient and obey the will of God.
Amen. Thank you. Sister Cynthia.
And also it has to do with when Jesus wanted, say wanted Jesus, so, and for us to each a promise takes away a little piece of our soul.
Exactly. Amen. Pastor Bruce?
And then we really focus on, I heard the people say James 4:7, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. Well, resist, we talk about how resist was a key component in the devil fleeing. You know, a lot of times, you know, we don't resist enough. You know, because resistance, you know, resistance is to act in opposition or to oppose, withstand the actions or the effect of something. So so a lot of times when Satan comes against us, you know, we don't resist. You know, for instance, you know, if we're trying to stop smoking and we're saying, okay, you know, I'm gonna stop smoking, it's time, blah, blah, blah. And then when that urge comes, you don't resist. And so what happens is you end up, you know, continuing to smoke. Or if that, you know, lust comes about, you don't resist, you know. So you have to submit to God first. Or submit to God means that we submit to what the Word of God says, submit to what the Holy Ghost says in that time. And that's what Jesus did. And so so we got to resist. So I think we spend a little time on that, too.
That goes back to what Brother Charles was saying, that sometimes being worldly or carnal is easier. You right. know, I'm reading a book about commitment and consistency by Bill Hybels, and one of the things that he talks about is delayed gratification is the key mm-hmm. to resistance and growth. Speaking.
I think with resistance, and also if you ain't got no words in you, you have nothing to pull out to resist. So you don't have nothing to fight with. So
Amen.
You have to get the word in you. So you have
some, right.
Understand them. I want to talk some more about that this evening. Thank you. Sister Tarifa.
I remember we talked about how do you get your soul saved.
Mm-hmm.
And you said that we have to submit to God and resist the devil, and you will save your soul.
Okay. All right. Thank you. All right, let's go. Matthew chapter 4, the kingdom of God, the beginning of the kingdom. The purpose of the lesson is to catch the excitement of being invited to join Jesus' compassionate and powerful kingdom. All right, we are going to start again at Matthew chapter 3. The reason why we're doing that is because we're looking at the events that followed immediately after Jesus had been baptized. So if you will go with me to Matthew chapter 3, starting at verse 16. When you get there, say amen.
Amen.
When he had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon him. And suddenly a voice came from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Matthew 4, verse 1. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit to the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, afterward he was hungry. Now, when the tempter came to him, he said, "If you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread." But he answered and said, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Verse 5. The devil took him up into the holy city, set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down. For it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "It is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God." Verse 8, again the devil took him up on an exceeding high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, "All these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Then Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." And we're going to be going now to down to verse 17. We're moving on a little bit. Verse 11, then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him. Verse 12, now when Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he departed to Galilee, and leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is by the sea in the regions of Zebulun and Naphtali, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, "The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea, beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light, and upon those who sat in the region and the shadow of death, light has dawned." From that time on, Jesus began to preach and say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Now that's a mouthful, isn't it? But trust me, when we're done, and it won't be tonight, you will have a full understanding. Tonight we are absolutely going to finish up temptation. and how Jesus was tempted, how he got out of it, how we can be tempted, and how we can get out of it. Amen? And tempted is to try, to make trial of, to test, for the purpose of ascertaining our quality, or how we think, or how we will behave. Amen? Okay, and this is what we talked about last week. What will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? And as Pastor Bruce said, the Greek word for soul is psyche. And as Kim said, that's our mind, will, and our intellect or emotions. We got to remember what the temptations were, how Satan tempted Jesus in these three ways, and he tempts us the same: to doubt the truth that he was God's son, to test the truth of his relationship, and to prematurely take what we think we have coming to us. Amen? All right, so I think we answered this question because we got into the devil leading, didn't we?
Yeah.
All right, so let's go there. Question number five, this is verses 12 through 17. Describe the transition from testing to ministry. What do they tell us about Jesus and his agenda? And we spoke about the devil leaving and how we get the devil to leave. And we identified our key words there. And we said how we got the devil to leave is submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. The two key components in getting the devil to leave you alone is to submit, which means to yield or surrender yourself to the will or authority of another. In this case, the other is God. And to resist, to actively oppose whatever that thing is that's drawing you or tempting you to basically handle your own business because you feel like God isn't taking care of it quick enough for you. Amen? Or you find that there's a quicker way to do it. Amen?
Amen.
Let me see here. Okay. Now, we talked about how to get the enemy to leave us alone, but there's something here I don't think we look for after the temptation is gone. There was something that we wanted or needed that the enemy placed the temptation in front of us to get, right? So we talked about how to escape the temptation, but the temptation is there because there's something we want or we need. So what happens when we escape the temptation? What happens to the want or the need? What happens to the want or the need? What did you say? I think I heard you, Pastor Corey. It's still there. So what to do? What were you going to say, Tom?
Trusting God provided.
Okay, but we do recognize, though, that even though the temptation is gone, the need is still there, right? So in other words, we suffer from low self-esteem, abandonment issues. The way we fix it is we love the one we're with. We have sex outside of marriage to fulfill that need. This one time you decided, I'm not doing that today, but did that take away the low self-esteem or the abandonment issue? Did that go away because we got the devil to leave?
No.
That need is still there, isn't it?
I know what you're talking about, but some situations I have to win. First of all, I have to consciously be willing to let that go. I got to make a choice.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to do that,
mm-hmm.
even though I know my flesh wants to.
Mm-hmm.
Then I ask God for the power and the strength to not do it. That's what I do once I get into it here. Personally, but I do that on certain situations as the tenth man's, our biggest lust. But I ask God for that anointing. I said, I want to serve you and be pure, because that's what you want me to do. So I had to ask him, I had to get a special prayer asking for the anointing and strength to do that. But I made a choice to do that first. Come from my heart. Then I asked him for the strength to do it.
All right. I'm going somewhere. Y'all know that, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
So Jesus was in the desert. He was hungry. He was thirsty. The devil tempted him. He resisted the devil. Did he get fed?
Not right away.
How many say you got fed? Come on, don't be ashamed, don't be afraid. How many say he got fed? How many say he didn't? Those who say he didn't get fed, why? Tony.
He got administered to by the angels through some, it wasn't revealed, but administered to me means that he was, his needs were fulfilled in some sort of way spiritually.
Okay. Who else said he didn't get fed? Adrian, you said he didn't get fed. Why? Adrian's right here.
Because the devil then, his son, took him to the top of the church and asked him to jump off. So how did he eat? He had to go through the other two.
That's the question. How did he eat?
Well, if you're talking about physical, spiritual, but physically, I didn't see anywhere. I'm just going off the scriptures. I didn't see anywhere in the scriptures where it said that, that he got fed.
Right.
How many of you say that he got fed, and why do you think he got fed? I'm on the fed side.
Yeah. Well, the reason I say he got fed is because the angels came and ministered to him.
Okay.
Basically, I would say he got fed because he ate off the word. I mean, that supplied what he needed.
Okay.
The word.
Yeah. Remember, you guys, I told you, sometimes we get too spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
Right. The scripture says that we don't eat off the bread alone.
Okay. How was he going to make it out the desert if he didn't eat?
We get commandments just like the Father from the heavens.
I'm going to tell you, Pastor Bruce, like Pastor Bruce said, the scripture is silent about it, but why does that word minister just have to mean spiritual? The angels ministered to him.
Mm-hmm.
Huh?
Right.
That means they met his needs. We do that all the time and call it ministry, don't we?
Yep.
So, but he got feds, I believe, have it. Anyone over on this side want to debate it further? He got ministered to by who?
The angels.
Angels. How many people believe in angels? If you believe in demons, you kind of got to believe in angels too. How many believe that angels minister today? Okay, now I want some examples. If you believe it, then you need to tell me. If you have an example, personal example or otherwise. Tony, Cynthia, Mary, Deacon?
Well, I'm a firm believer that there are such things as guardian angels. And it's sort of like you, if you have faith and you believe in angels, which you also, vice versa, there are demons out there, and I believe Satan sends them out to collect souls and, you know, spirits and whatever. And so it's a war between angels and demons. But I have a situation where I had gotten in an accident, and I survived it, and it was due to something that it was miraculous, and I felt that I had some spiritual help. It was something that pulled me out of it.
Hmm. Okay, Cynthia.
I believe in angels such as my mother. Since she had passed, there's been times I've been really down and out and had hit bottom. When you're asking for help or praying for help, when you need it, then I felt her spirit come and touch me and give me strength and power. And it's like a vision that you can see that where it's coming from. And it's not her, but it's in the vision of like an angel. You know?
Okay, thank you. Deacon Curtis, and then Leo finally joined us. Thank you.
Well, I can tell you a lot of times the angels have grown me home, and I don't know how I got there.
Ooh, yeah.
In one incident that I was parked in a little bitty car spot this big, and I've been out all night drunk and everything else, and I woke up and I couldn't get into that spot sober. And I know when I woke up my battery was dead and everything was dead, but I was safe.
How many of us have been there?
Yeah.
Leo.
I kinda always believe in anger because I'm being in a few difficult situation there. That being angel around me to what I'm still here in this world. But today I believe more than ever because they working with me every day. I'm getting 5 o'clock in the morning from here to the streets to go to work. I'm between people and I even have one thoughts about drugs, about alcohol, about nothing. And came back here like I'm being here 50 years, I'm being here only 30 days. Matter of fact, people, tomorrow I got 30 days clean and sober.
Thank you, William, for that blessing and for everybody that's been around me every day.
Amen. Rick and then James. That's Brother Rick right there. You're going to have to, or you're going to let Andre do it if you can't figure out how to gracefully do it. Thank you.
I believe in angels because I wouldn't be here right now if it wasn't for some of the people that have looked out for me, like my daughter, to get me through them overdoses and the bad things I've done in my life.
Amen.
Amen.
James.
I believe, too, that it was the angel that helped me to keep from smoking. Because when I was in church and y'all were praying for me, I put a half a pack of cigarettes in the coffee can, but that didn't necessarily keep me from smoking in the future. Mm-hmm. But every time that I would go out, there was somebody, or even in my mind, I would say there was something that was saying, "Do you really want that cigarette, or it's not?"
I think that might be the Holy Spirit.
So I just stopped. I was like, "Holy hell, I'm smoking. I don't have a need at all."
Okay. Tom, and then Tori.
I know that's an angel.
It's long story, but I'll abbreviate. I was having a tantrum one time over some relationship issues, and I'd already tore up all the furniture in the house, and there was a sink full of dirty dishes, which I had a pet peeve about. And I was standing at the sink beating these dishes with a club. And in the middle of all this noise, there was a real faint knock on the door. And I'm just livid now, but I heard this knock and I walked over and I jerked that door open because I thought it was going to be one of the neighbors complaining. And it was three little children standing there with tears coming out their eyes. And their little cheeks were beet red because it's like cold in September and they were lost. And I believe that it was angels informing those children to take me out of that mess.
We're going
to
talk about that. Tori.
Yeah, I'm going to make mine short too. I remember when I first got here, you used to talk about the story about the girl that got shot and how...
She got murdered.
Yeah, she got murdered in the parking lot and about the angel on the roof. And I thought, you're right, these people are crazy. And I remember in March, I was walking home from the bus and it had just snowed. And I remember seeing footprints on the roof, and I'm thinking, Pastor Bruce is crazy, he's on the roof. And I looked down, and when I looked back up, it was not Pastor Bruce, it was a physical angel. And I never believed in angels after that, and I never believed in ghosts, and I still don't, but of ghosts, I think that they're spirits, I think it's different. And so it was that actually, and a week later, everything fell into play. I got a job, my kids came home very quickly after that. Because something, that's all it was going to take to open my eyes. So.
Amen. That was when we were living here, and it, that incident terrified me. And what finally got me over it was the Lord giving me that scripture about He will give us angels charge over you. And He gave me a vision of an angel standing over there on that back flat part of the building with a flaming sword. And that He was watching over us. And no evil has come to this place mm-hmm. since then.
Jesus.
Since that time. So now, let me prove this. Let's prove this.
I just
I believe in them because I've seen an angel, I've seen a demon, and I've seen a ghost. So that's why I believe.
Okay. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Amen. All right. Shall we prove it in scripture?
Amen.
Okay. All right. Yes, son. Yes, son. Hebrews 13:2 out of the New Living Translation. Don't forget to show hospitality to strangers, for some who have done this have entertained angels without realizing it. The King James Version says, don't be careful to entertain, not to entertain strangers, because you may have done it unawares. My experience with that was when I lived in Los Angeles and it was payday, and I was running on my lunch break to go spend some money, and there was a homeless guy sitting out front, and I didn't really make a practice of giving money to homeless people because they're typically addicts that are... But I specifically heard the Holy Ghost say, minister to him. And I'm like, yeah. But it was just loud and clear. And I'm in a hurry. I'm not doing it. So I get inside, and then I get a pang of the guilties. And so I buy a bottle of water, and I said, okay, Lord, I'll do it. When I got outside, he was gone. And this scripture came in my spirit. I cried all the way back to work. We don't know. Just like you just said, that's an incident. You don't know. Just like the scripture says that that Satan will turn himself into an angel of light, yes, if he can, to deceive the very elect, there are actual angels of light in this earth, and you don't know who they are.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever had someone do you a kindness, and then you turn around to thank them, and they're gone? Mm-hmm. Anybody ever experienced something like that? You never know. Charles.
That scripture there, you know, I always remember that scripture, but also a spinoff on that scripture is not to judge people, because the reason I'm saying that, I've always tied that scripture in where it says, do not be a respecter of a people, of a person, be a respecter of people, because you'll entertain somebody to come in with the nice fine clothes. That somebody was not dressed as that, you won't entertain. And just like it says here, you entertain the stranger. You know what I'm saying? So mm-hmm. You can't judge, but don't do it just because he looks better. Entertain the person that don't look better. Mm-hmm. That's why I always tie in with that scripture that you just said.
Amen. Thank you. Next one. Hebrews again, Pastor Corey. I always knew about Hebrews 2, but I thought it very interesting that the very next verse, which is the same train of thought, it says, remember those in prison as if you were there yourself. Remember also those being mistreated as if you felt their pain in your own bodies. Paul put both of those together for a reason. You know, and we, that's what we do here. Amen? And Jesus said in the scriptures, and I should have put that up there, where he talked about, get away from me, I never knew you, because when I was in prison, you didn't come and visit me. I was hungry and you didn't feed me. I was naked and you didn't put clothes on me. And then the person answered back and said, when were you in prison and I didn't see you? When were you hungry and I didn't feed you? I never saw you naked. And Jesus said, as much as you didn't do it to the least of them, you've done it to me. So when we neglect the needs of other people, Jesus says, that's the same as neglecting me.
So are you saying that we should, at all times, no matter, like if we're walking and we see somebody, to help them at all times?
I knew this was going to come up. You got to be careful. And you got to be led by the Spirit.
Okay.
You can't just let everybody into your house.
Right.
Okay, because there's a lot of translations of this that I didn't put up there intentionally that said, welcome strangers into your home, because you never know if they're going to be an angel. And I don't want anybody to get confused, okay, or misled. You have to be led by the Spirit.
Right. Amen.
Okay?
Well, I'm talking about just like on the streets. Like, you know how those people stay out and they need money or food.
Again, you have to be discerning.
Right.
One of the things that I told Tori about that was I used to keep a bunch of Bible tracts and a bunch of daily breads with me, you know, and I did the Peter and Paul thing, you know, silver and gold have I none, but as much as I have, I give unto you. You have to be discerning about it. You know, the other day, a couple weeks ago, there was a young lady in line ahead of me. She couldn't get her debit card to work. It couldn't get it to work. And I'm getting irritated. And then when she finally did get it to work, there wasn't no money in it. Mm-hmm. You know? And I'm like, thank you, God. And, you know, and I just, you know, it was $12 and I just paid it. And everybody's like, oh, you know? And I just like, thank you. I'm going to pay you back. And I said, how are you going to pay me back? You don't know me. I said, just get out of the line, please. I really did. But she laughed like, wow, did she? And the cashier was like, what'd you do that for? Right. Well, she don't know I've been waiting for that kind of an opportunity, right. You know? So. All right, Hebrews 1:14. Are not all the angels, and it says lowercase a, when it's lowercase, when it's uppercase a, what is it?
God.
Jesus or God. So now, are not all the angels ministering spirits sent out by God to serve, accompany, protect those who will inherit salvation? Of course they are. Mm-hmm. We all have one.
Amen.
Amen.
You may not ever see them.
But they,
there's a couple times when I've been on the freeway and almost got hit, and I know I didn't swerve my car, but somehow my car just whoop.
Amen.
I believe that was my angel.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody?
Amen. Yeah.
Those are angels. And then I thought it was really cool. We're going to go back to Jesus and Satan and the temptation. And remember, Satan used this scripture to tempt Jesus, right? And God turned it around and ministered to Jesus out of the same verse that Satan misquoted. He said, for he will command his angels in regard to you to protect, defend, and guard you in all your ways of obedience and service. Once Jesus was obedient to God, he resisted Satan, then God said, okay, now I'll meet your need.
Mm-hmm.
As soon as the devil left, the angels came. And yeah, they might have ministered to him spiritually, but he was already in a spiritual realm. What he needed was physical. Do you follow me?
Mm-hmm.
When we reject meeting our needs in a worldly way, yes, you'll gain spiritual victory. But again, like I said, our spiritual need hasn't been met. I rejected relationships and sex outside of marriage for 4 years.
Mm.
Yeah, laugh.
No,
the first couple of years was rough, man. It was rough. That need was still in me. I was still lonely. Somebody who her addiction was promiscuity. Those feelings were still there.
Right.
But as time went on and I kept resisting and I kept finding things to do, I want to tell you what, I must have painted my whole house. Became the youth Sunday school teacher. I did anything I could. Could not watch people kissing on TV. I changed the channel. Whatever I could do to resist that urge. And yes, sometimes I even cried. Mm-hmm. Till I got to the point in about year 3.5, and I said, this ain't so bad. Thank you, Lord. If I'm supposed to be single, I'm good. And then God said, okay.
Oh,
and wait, how did I meet him? I was serving. Wasn't thinking about a relationship or a man, because God had delivered me from that. And when I was ministering, then he ministered back to me. Anybody?
Yeah.
Charles, I got 5 minutes, so you better, 30 seconds, dude.
Okay, so what you're saying is,
I heard somebody say what you said. What you're saying is, until you learned to be alone and was content with that, then God gave you something.
You got
to
be good with
that's
you.
That's powerful.
You,
yeah.
And him.
That's powerful.
You know, and when I give that testimony, people are like, 4 years? Well, that's how long it took me. Maybe I was complaining for 3.5 of those years.
Huh. Amen.
Maybe I did it to myself. Come on, somebody. We still have needs, and God knows that we have needs. And when we do it His way, He teaches us to be patient and wait on Him, and He will provide.
Amen.
I want to give you a couple of things from a favorite commentary of mine, Matthew Henry. Some thoughts that he had on this. Just as there is a world of evil, malicious spirits that fight against Christ, His church, and all individual believers, so there is also a world of holy, blessed spirits engaged and employed for us. It is not just about fighting the enemy. It's also about receiving and open and looking to where the blessing is and how God can meet that need.
Amen.
Even if He says no. My need was met by ministering to teenagers and getting out of myself, by ministering to homeless people. Although God may allow His people to be brought into need and difficulties, He will take effective care that their needs are supplied, and He will send angels to feed them rather than see them perish. And you've heard me talk about this. It's, do not be afraid, little flock, for it gives God great pleasure to give you the kingdom. He doesn't want to see us suffering. He doesn't want to see us hungry. He doesn't want to see us without a job. He doesn't want to see us lonely. But it's a process, right?
Right.
Christ was helped after the temptation so He might be encouraged to continue in His purpose. We are helped in our temptations so that we might be encouraged to trust Him.
Amen.
After every time He meets one of your needs, it's not so hard to expect Him to meet the next one.
That's right.
That first one is rough. But after that, then it's like, you know, Holy Ghost, we used to worry year after year after year, every year, the Williams Prepared Place would be short on money. Some of y'all would hear that. Me and Pastor Bruce would go 3 or 4 months without a paycheck. And I would be in a funk and crying and upset and worried. And my sister would say, why do you go through this every year? And God, and then you get on the other side and you look back, not a bill didn't go unpaid, never didn't have no groceries. Now maybe somebody brought us groceries. Because that happened a lot too.
Amen.
But those were angels ministering to us. And it got, we've been doing this for 15 years. We are in year number 16. And at the beginning of the year, the Lord said, no more. You ain't going to have to go without any more. And those of you who work for me, y'all are witness that is starting to happen. God is moving and He's putting some things
ma'am.
In motion. And what did I learn from that? Mm-hmm. I learned how to make turn a penny into copper wire. I learned how to budget. I learned how to not be so flagrant with any kind of money that we got in.
Uh-huh. Amen.
Did it take me 15 years? Was I being a poor steward? No. But there were some things that I wouldn't let go of. Certain programs, certain grants. It was like we was on federal program welfare. And we wouldn't let go of it because we were scared to trust God. Now I'm just might as well just give the testimony. Until then, people said, we're not going to give you any more money if you don't start letting people, Lord forgive me, nothing wrong with people who live under the bridge. Nothing wrong with people who are down on Skid Row, but that's not who we minister to.
Right.
And they said, you will start letting those people come to the WPP. If you don't, we're taking your money away. And you know what I said?
Take it.
Take it. You know what they did?
They took it.
They took it. You know what happened right after that? And my heart was pounding. It was pounding when I sat there and told them people that. And they took the money. But God turned around and sent an angel and sent us not only just the same, that sent us money, but twice the money
yes,
we've been
did.
Getting every year for the last 15 years.
Woo! Yes!
Resist the devil. and he will flee. Learn to trust God. No temptation, regardless of its source, has overtaken or enticed you that is not common to human experience, nor is any temptation unusual or beyond human resistance. There's nothing in this earth that we can't overcome or right. say no to.
Amen.
Cigarette smokers. You laugh, but y'all gonna be hitting them as soon as you get out of my car. It don't bother you. That's nervous, guilty laugh. He is compassionate and trustworthy, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your ability to resist it.
Amen.
But along with the temptation, he has in the past and is now and will always provide a way out. Always.
Amen.
And as soon as you get on the other side, he will minister to your needs. As well, provide the way out as well so that you will be able to endure without yielding and will overcome the temptation with joy.
Amen.
James 1, verses 2 through 4. Consider it nothing but joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you fall into various trials. Be assured that the testing of your faith through experience produces endurance, leading to spiritual maturity and inner peace. I'm probably going to embarrass her a little bit, but when I read this, I thought about Amber. I was talking to her last week about some things, and she was kind of running by me some things that she was going to do or some decisions she had made, and I was like, yeah, that's right, that's good. And she kind of laughed and she said, it feels good knowing that I'm making the right decisions. You remember that? Leading to spiritual maturity and inner peace. Because you're making good decisions.
Amen.
And God is meeting your needs. Let endurance have its perfect result and do a thorough work, so that you may be perfect and completely developed in your faith, lacking in nothing.
That's right.
Okay, I'll read this real quick and then I'm going to close out. Consider it a sheer gift, friends, when tests and challenges come at you from all sides. You know that under pressure, your faith life is forced into the open and shows its true colors. So don't try to get out of anything prematurely. Let it do its work so you become mature and well-developed, not deficient in any way. That's what you're going to go through some temptations. You're going to go through some hard stuff.
That's right.
But go on and go through it. Because on the other side, it's a blessing. Pastor Corey.
You know, I'm just looking at this scripture in Philippians 4:19. Paul said it in the New Living Translation.
Mm-hmm.
And this same God who takes care of me will supply all your needs from his glorious riches, which have been given to us in Christ Jesus. So he's saying that anything that we have need of, God is going to take, is already taking care of it in Jesus Christ. All we have to do is go get it.
Amen.
And so when we have, and what pulls it out is our faith in the finished works of Jesus, but that grace allows us to access that through our faith.
Thank you. Alexis, would you turn the lights down for me real quick? I want to finish this way, and I want y'all to be able to see it. We've been talking about angels ministering to us, and we have to know that God is with you no matter what you do. He told Joshua, have I not commanded you to be strong and courageous? Do not be terrified or dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go and whatever you do. We have angels watching over us. What I want to share with you is these are not the angels that are watching over us.
Right, right.
Angels are not cute little babies.
They grown warriors.
Don't let the devil fool you into thinking that that's all angels are, is a couple of sweet little babies. No, these are the angels that are watching over us.
Right there. That's the one. I'm serious.
I'm so bad. Yeah, that's the one. Y'all move out the way. She's about to get hit by the
They do.
That's the
one.
I have to tell you what the men did at what the men in Sodom and Gomorrah happened to them when they started lusting over angels. Y'all better move away from them. the angels that are watching over us. Amen?
Amen.
We have reinforcements. Psalms 91:11 says, "For he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways." In Jesus' name, that's the message. Somebody get a fan and a drink of water for Mary and pray over her.